It's my pleasure today to introduce Lauryn Oates, our next speaker. Lauryn is a human rights activist and practitioner who concentrates upon international developments, women's rights, and education in conflict zones. Lauryn is younger than me, yet also has a distinguished career greater than I. At only 14, Lauryn read a newspaper article describing the new regime in Afghanistan called the Taliban and their treatment of women and girls. She was horrified by this, so she wrote a petition demanding that the world respond to the Taliban's misogynist policies and has continued her work ever since. So currently, she is projects director of the Canadian Women for Women in Afghanistan and a doctoral student in literacy education at University of British Columbia. She is the founder of the Vancouver and Montreal chapters of the not-for-profit solidarity network Canadian Women for Women in Afghanistan and is currently their projects director. She manages the Accelerate Teaching Training Program and 12 other projects in Afghanistan, and she tells me that immediately after this and hosting people in Vancouver from Afghanistan, she's going back there to Afghanistan. On June 1st of this year, she was able to celebrate her 1,200th teacher in the Kabul province and has put now more than 50,000 girls through school. An incredible achievement. She's a recipient of several awards and distinctions, including the 2000 Chatelaine Women of the Year, 2001 National Post Canada Women of Influence, and a YTV Achievement Award for Public Service. She's also was named by the Globe and Mail as the one of the top 10 Canadians to watch in 2009. Her list of publications is so long, I really can't tell you them all. It truly is so long. But one I want you to be aware of that very much intrigued me this summer was entitled, If Speaking Truth is Offensive, Let Us Offend. So with that, I'd like to have Lauryn now take the podium.
So good afternoon, everyone. It's morning for me. I'm on West Coast time, so still full from breakfast. But I thought I'd start off telling you a little story that might explain why I do my women's rights work through the education sector. This is a scene from Afghanistan, and it's probably very different from the Afghanistan that you see daily or nightly on the news. The chasm between the Afghanistan that I know and the Afghanistan that I think is portrayed in the media in Canada could not be wider. So I want to introduce you to a place called the Dara Valley, which is only about 45 minutes, about an hour outside of Kabul City in Kabul province in eastern Afghanistan. A friend of mine named Esok, this fellow, who's a human rights lawyer in Kabul, is from this village. He grew up there and now works in Kabul as a lawyer. He was a refugee for a while in Iran. His main work is to take women's divorce cases and help them win divorces in the courts, which is actually really, really difficult to do in the legal system in Afghanistan. He's an incredibly courageous and very serious kind of guy. And 2 years ago, in July 2008, another Canadian colleague, a librarian, and myself were working on our teacher training program, and it was really, really, really hot in the city. And so Esok said, let's go to my village and we'll have a picnic there and we'll just relax for the day. So we went to this area in the valley. This is his brother and his nephew. It's an absolutely stunningly beautiful place. It's very green. There's natural springs, the most delicious water. I drank about 8 liters of it. I couldn't stop. And lots of fruit growing there, lots of herbs, apricots, almonds, natural sage growing by the river. It's just really, really beautiful. So we picnicked and we were chatting with people. There's only about 1,000 people that live in the cluster of villages around there, and maybe 100 or so in this particular village. And At some point, we went into a grove of mulberry trees, and the kids were climbing up to the top of the trees and shaking the branches, and then the women were standing below holding blankets, and the berries were falling there, and then we would eat them right from there. It was a really nice day. And as we were in this grove, some of the elders came and gathered around us, and we were chatting with them, and we asked them, about their community. And one of the first things they mentioned was that they were really frustrated that they had no girls' school in anywhere near their village in their district. They did have a boys' high school, and the government had just built that. And they felt that it was going to be years before the government came back again and gave them a girls' school. And so the literacy rate for girls and women in this whole area was 0%. There wasn't a woman or girl who could read or write. And they were really ashamed of this. It was concerning for them, and they didn't know quite what to do. There was no one even who could teach. They needed a woman teacher, and there was no one. So we started chatting with them about a project that we had partnered with in Kabul called the Noor Education Center. And there, these Afghan women had set up a girls' library where the girls and adult women could also come to the library and take literacy classes in the library and then be borrowing the books, which was enhancing their literacy. And it had worked really well. And they immediately kind of latched onto this idea, and a man stepped forward and he said, well, I could give one floor of my house for the library. And another said, I'll build the shelves for it. And so we kind of went into this cost-sharing agreement with them where we said, we'll go back to Canada and we'll raise money for the books and we'll raise money for the salary for a literacy teacher. So that was in July. This is the mulberry orchard, and the kids listening to us have this discussion. So that was July 2008, and by October, the Dara Village Library opened. And first we had 7 women enroll, then 10, then 17, and then 24. And it kept climbing, and they were all different ages. They were, kids to right up to women in their 50s and 60s. And, sure enough, after a few months of being in the classes, the women learned to read, as happens. And Esok, who's always so serious and stern, and who is also someone who's, won divorce cases and has prosecuted criminals and has had all these extraordinary experiences, he'd never seen anything in his life as powerful as watching someone turn letters into words and words into sentences and sentences into ideas. And he used to call me on Skype when I was back in Canada, and he would just keep saying, it's everything. Literacy is everything. And it wasn't long before some of the women in the literacy class formed a shura, which is a local political council, alongside the men's shura. So they started participating and making decisions for the community. And then they wanted all their daughters to go to school. And they wanted to start businesses. And they wanted to read about better nutrition practices for their families. They wanted to read about better health practices. It was so incredibly transformative. And it made the literacy rate skyrocket in this community in a matter of months. The men noticed the changes too. And it wasn't long before they came to us and they said, we want a literacy class too for the men. So we were a women's organization, but we talked about that and we saw how this could reinforce the women's access to education. So we started the men's Dara Village literacy class as well. They go to their classes in the boys' high school after classes, and the women go in the library. And then a year later, a neighboring village had got wind of this library and all these people taking books home, and the mullahs were talking in the mosque every Friday about how all the good Muslims should use the Dara Village library, and they knew that there were some religious books in there, and they really supported it. And then another village came and they had heard about this and they petitioned us. They wanted their own library and literacy class as well. And we've just had our third request, so it's kind of having this ripple effect. It's a microcosm of the impact that literacy can have and how inherently tied it is to women's rights and to gender equality. And so you'll hear me talking a lot about the right to read and the right to learn when I'm talking about gender equality, because I can't separate the two. And I started working in human rights and gravitated towards education because I saw that that's how it was going to happen. That's how women's rights were going to be protected and promoted. So this is the library, and it's on the upper floor. And it only has about 1,000 books, but on any given day, 100 of those books are signed out in this small community. And then we donate other books as we've been able to raise them. And then the books are mostly in the local language, in Dari, and some in Pashto, and just a few in English. So that's the story of the Dari Village Library. And I'm just going to switch presentations now and put some photos up in the background for you. That'll just rotate as I speak, and you'll see some images from the kinds of projects that we support, as well as the work in Canada, because these two are linked. You know, everything we do in Canada is tied into the impact that we're able to make in Afghanistan, and we're mostly all volunteers and ordinary people who have come together and have a lot of fun in the process of doing this work. So you'll see some of that, and if you happen to get terribly bored listening to me, well, you have some photos to distract you. So the theme of the talk is gender equality in the world we want to live in, fairness and dignity for women in the developing world. And the only thing I really know anything about is Afghanistan. But Afghanistan being the site of a very recent and extreme battle for women's equality, by extension, I came to know something about that topic as well. And if you dabble in questions of gender equality, women's rights, you'll eventually run up against cultural relativism. And if you start mouthing off about universal human rights and critiquing cultural relativist stances, you will eventually start offending people as well. So that also became something that I got to know, was offending people. And so I inadvertently do it quite often. But I think it's more important than ever to draw a distinction between offending people, offending people's sensibilities, and insulting them, because these are not the same thing. And we can't stifle our criticism by always trying to be polite and not speaking up. And it gets easier, you know. The more you offend people, it gets easier as you go. So that will basically form the order of my remarks. From talking about Afghanistan, to women's rights, to cultural relativism, to being offensive. And I think I'm among like-minded folks here, so you know, hope that may make me extra offensive, because I'll be letting loose and everything. But I hope, apologies in advance for anyone I do offend. And to perhaps to contextualize what I mean about this link between cultural relativism and women's rights, last night I was speaking with some American women who work for an organization similar to ours in the U.S., and we've been working on forming a coalition, and I said, let's call it, like, the Feminist Coalition for, and they said, no, feminist is a bad word, it's a dirty word, we can't say that, and I think it's really sad that that's happened. And I want to read you a definition of feminism from Ophelia Benson's Dictionary of Fashionable Nonsense. Has anyone heard of Ophelia Benson? Yeah, she's an extraordinary writer, and she has a great blog called Butterflies and Wheels. So this will explain it a bit. So her definition is, another item that depends on location, an excellent thing in the West, but a form of Eurocentric hegemonic discourse in the Third World. Subaltern cultures have their own customs that give them meaning. And if those customs include mutilating or imprisoning or murdering women, that's their business. It's patronizing and condescending for Western feminists not to realize that third world women have agency and are perfectly able to choose to be treated like dirt all by themselves.